Good morning. Thank you, Dixon, for that nice introduction. People often ask me about innovation and how you do it and how you actually bring new ideas to clinical reality. And today's talk is sort of a compilation of two talks that I had previously given. First one about how to innovate, and the second one about bringing new ideas to clinical reality. There is some overlap, but they're a little bit different. Now, this is where I practice. This is Columbia University Medical Center in northern Manhattan. And it's a big place, very busy clinical services. My disclosures. I have no financial disclosures. Columbia University pays me. My wife spends the money. It's essentially a direct pass-through. I do have some fiduciary responsibilities, as you could see, none of which really impact on this talk today. So initially, I'll talk about innovation. And if you're not already in a 12-step program, I'll give you one. In terms of how to innovate. And then in terms of bringing new ideas to clinical reality, I've brought a number of new ideas to clinical reality, which I'll tell you about and give you examples from, but I'll give you 15 lessons learned. So 12 steps and 15 lessons learned, probably in about a little bit less than an hour. And there is some overlap between the steps and the lessons. Now, in talking about innovation, I'm going to talk about Shimon Peres, Charcot, Louis Pasteur, Ecclesiastes, DeBakey, Laser Greenfield, Malcolm Gladwell, and Bernie Gelbaum. Now, you should be asking yourselves two questions. One is, how's he going to put all this together? And the second is, who the hell is Bernie Gelbaum? So you'll find out. So a dictionary definition of innovation is a new idea, device, or method, or the act or process of introducing new ideas, devices, or methods. So why am I talking about innovation? And why did Dr. Kaufman pick me? Well, I did the first dual renal transplant. I was an early advocate for removing disincentives to donation, and as part of that, with a urologist named Lou Cavusi, we did the first laparoscopic live donor nephrectomy. I then went on to author protocols for desensitization in preparation for transplantation, utilizing plasmapheresis and IVIG to remove the alloantibody or anti-ABO blood group isoglutinins. I did what I thought was the first paired kidney exchange in the United States, but unbeknownst to us at the time, a group in Boston had beaten us by about 6 months. And then with my friends, also transplant surgeons, Amy Friedman and Tom Peters, we were the first to identify safety concerns with hemostatic clips in living kidney donation. And then I was also the first person to use and advocate for including compatible donor and recipient pairs in paired kidney exchanges or kidney swaps. So these are the sort of the things I've done. And it's been a over 20-year personal evolution of ideas. It started with using expanded criteria donor organs, moving to dual kidney transplants, then looking to remove disincentives to living kidney donation, again, to try and increase the organ supply, which then led to the laparoscopic donor nephrectomy, which, as you'll hear, led to desensitization for a positive cross-match, which then led to ABO-incompatible transplant, which then led to paired kidney donation to overcome these incompatibilities in an organizational manner, and then the use of compatible donor and recipient pairs. And more recently, I've been more interested in process and organizational aspects of delivery of surgical care and transplant care. So let's talk about innovation. Enough about me. So number one, anyone can innovate. So innovation, just like almost anything else, could be a learned process. And although there are some people where it's more intuitive and they're more natural at it, I believe that anyone can innovate. Step number two, be dissatisfied. And this quote, dissatisfaction leads to progress comes from Shimon Peres, taken a little bit out of context. But nonetheless, I think in order to innovate, you need to be dissatisfied and say, why is something the way it is? And how could we do things better? And to do that, you need to live outside your comfort zone. Okay, we get very used to doing the things that we do, and we take them for granted that they couldn't be, that they could be improved upon. So step number four, getting back to what Dr. Kaufman was talking about, innovation really equals problem solving. Okay, and there are two aspects. There's an innovative solution to a problem. There are two aspects to this problem solving, and sometimes the innovation is in defining the problem, and other times the innovation is in solving the problem, okay? And they're not, obviously not mutually exclusive. And here's another unique solution to a problem. Step number five, ask questions. Why is something done that way? What data supports what we do? How can it be done better, safer, more efficiently, less painfully, cheaper, easier? Okay? And oftentimes when you start asking these questions, particularly in clinical realm, we see that the evidence to support what we do could be vanishingly small or not existent at all, or at least only anecdotal. Step six. Ask more questions. Why is it done this way? Who started it and why? What alternatives did they consider? What are the biggest complaints with how we do this? How is this done in other localities or other disciplines? We tend to be very siloed frequently, and I think that's to our detriment. What different assumptions did they make or constraints did they have when they started doing whatever they did? And how can I apply any of the above to what I do? This is another innovative solution. Which now gets us to Charcot. Now, Charcot was the preeminent neurologist in the 19th century, and his most famous pupil was Sigmund Freud. And Freud recorded that Charcot said to him, I won't read you the French, but he basically said, theories are fine, but that doesn't prevent the facts from existing. Okay? So there are a lot of things that, you know, there are theories about, and then the facts are incongruous with them, and we need to look for a paradigm shift. Step number seven, look for assumptions that may be invalid or based on limited or poor data. And that gets to Louis Pasteur, who said, chance favors the prepared mind. Okay? And I think this is the key, a key concept in terms of innovation. Things will present themselves, and that's what you need to seize upon. Step number eight, look for answers in other disciplines. And here's where we get to Ecclesiastes, where Ecclesiastes wrote, several thousand years ago, there's nothing new under the sun. And you'll find that there are many solutions to problems that we face in other disciplines or other localities. And I'll give you two examples of this. Here's obviously famous Dr. Michael DeBakey, who one of his great innovations was to invent the peristaltic roller pump, which he needed a solution to figure out how to pump blood for cardiac bypass and to do it without destroying the blood. As DeBakey told the story, you know, he went to the library and started, you know, trying to find as much information as he could about pumps. And he was being very unsuccessful in finding anything that he could find that could be of use. And a friend of his, I think it had been his college roommate, who was an engineer, said, you're in the medical library. You're making a mistake there. You should be in the engineering library. You'll find everything you need to know about pumps there and not in the medical library. So DeBakey followed his advice, went to the medical library, the engineering library, and came up with the peristaltic roller pump based on his findings there. The second example I give is Dr. Greenfield, who obviously everyone knows is famous for the Greenfield filter. Now, prior to Greenfield, there were a number of methods used to occlude or obstruct the vena cava to prevent pulmonary emboli. So why is Greenfield famous? Well, he invented the conical filter, which is a filter that doesn't limit flow. Prior to him, people actually plicated the vena cava, or they put clips around it, which would narrow its diameter. Or there was even a device, an intraluminal caval device called the Moben-Uden filter, which I'm sure there are a couple of people here in the audience that remember those. But basically, those looked like the little umbrellas that you get in your drinks at those little paper umbrellas. It looked sort of like that and was flow limiting. So how did Greenfield come up with the idea of a conical filter? Well, at the time, he was on faculty in Oklahoma, and his neighbor was a chemical engineer in the petroleum industry, and he was having a discussion with his neighbor about this problem of having to, prevent clot from going up the cava and not limiting blood flow in the cava. And his neighbor said, well, in the petroleum industry, when we drill oil up from the ground, all kinds of gunk comes up with the oil, and we have these conical filters in our pipes that catch this gunk, and hence his work on the conical filter. So both these gentlemen, got inspirations from other industries and outside sources. Step number 9, be confident, prepare for criticism. If you're right, you're going to be criticized. If you're wrong, you're going to be criticized. You just have to have a pretty thick skin, because people are resistant to change or new ideas. And these guys look like they're having a great time, and I'm sure we'd all be critical of them. So this is the process: dissatisfaction, identification of a problem, solutions, and now the dissemination and adoption of how you get something, an innovation, out there. Now, most people think that new ideas will be adopted in a linear fashion, but this is absolutely never the case. And what we will always see is this sigmoid-shaped curve. And here now, to invoke Malcolm Gladwell, this inflection point is called the tipping point, okay? And so the question then becomes, if you want to get a new idea out there, how do you shorten this flat point to get to the tipping point and the sigmoid, the logarithmic phase of the curve? Well, this was the curve for laparoscopic donor nephrectomy. I could tell you I know exactly when this tipping point occurred. It occurred at the American Society of Transplant Surgeons meeting, the third year we were presenting it in 1998, and I was presenting our data, and I gave my presentation, and a gentleman in the first row to my left-hand side got up and started yelling at me, "You're going to kill people, you're going to make us all kill people doing this operation, it's immoral, blah, 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 blah." And then in the very back row on the right-hand side, another gentleman stood up and started yelling at him and said, "This is exactly like laparoscopic cholecystectomy. There's no one in this room now who would have an open cholecystectomy." And the two of them were yelling at each other across this vast auditorium with about 800 people in it. And eventually, when they both stopped yelling at each other and came up for air, Dr. Kaufman's old boss, Frank Stewart, stood up and said, "We started doing this at Northwestern, and we think it's a good thing." And that was the tipping point. If you still don't believe this about the sigmoid-shaped curve, here's the growth of kidney pair donation or kidney swaps in the United States. And then one third example, This is from an article that Ken Brayman from University of Virginia recently published in Journal American College of Surgeons, which shows the use of the Buckwalter retractor. So very, very reproducible, these sigmoid-shaped curves. So again, the question, how do you shorten that flat period to get these ideas out there? So step number 10 is to look for respected individuals with sufficient gravitas to champion your innovation. And there's a reason for that. So organizational psychologists have studied innovation, and they've studied how it gets adopted. And innovators basically make up about 3% of the population, okay? And everyone thinks they're crazy, and no one believes them. Except there are about 12-13% of the population who are called the naturals, or the early adopters. And it's these people, the people who would have sufficient gravitas, there are people in here that have sufficient gravitas that other people will listen to. The next group is what's called the silent majority. They're not a majority, they're only about 35% of the population, but they're the ones who say, okay, I'm not going to listen to the innovators because these guys are crazy, but these guys I know are, you know, there are people here that I know are solid and respectable, and if they think it's a good idea, it's a good idea. The next group of the population, which is also about 35% of the population, are what the organizational psychologists call the cynically inclined. And you know these people. These are the people who say, this is a stupid idea. I don't know why we're doing it. You know, I don't know why I have to do this. But nonetheless, come along and do it after, you know, the other people are doing it. And then you have a small group, about 15% of the population, who the psychologists call the resistors. These are the people who, no matter what the data shows, no matter what everyone else is doing, will not change, and you basically have to wait till they die off. So, anyway, the point is, so if you want to shorten that curve, you got to find the people in this group, the group of the naturals or the early adopters, that have the gravitas that other people will listen to. Step number 11, practice. Like everything else, the more you do it, the better you'll get at it. And now I'll invoke Bernie Gelbaum. Bernie Gelbaum was my college calculus professor. He was an eminent mathematician in his own right. But in the context of calculus, he was talking about, I could teach you to play the piano in less than 1 minute. Each key corresponds to a note. Depress the key with your fingers. All the rest is practice. Okay, and again, the same with innovation. So, step number 12, innovation should really be a way of life. You know, think about how to like shave differently in the morning, how to do your grocery shopping differently. The more you think about it, the easier it becomes to live outside your comfort zone. So, the summary of the 12 steps, number 1, anyone can innovate, 2, be dissatisfied, 3, live outside your comfort zone, 4, innovation equals problem solving, 5, ask questions, 6, ask more questions, 7, look for assumptions that may be invalid or based on poor data, 8, look for answers in other disciplines, 9, be confident and prepare for criticism, 10, look for respected individuals to champion your innovation, 11, practice, 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 and 12, make innovation a way of life. So now let's talk about, now we've innovated, how do we bring these new ideas to clinical reality? And I'm going to talk about sort of where my work has been, and this is sort of a flowchart of the academic that I've work that I've done, where my main focus, if you know these seem like disparate areas, is to increase the organ supply and remove disincentives to donation. And that led to the laparoscopic donor nephrectomy, and then, like I said, led to the use of immunologically incompatible donors, which led to protocols for desensitization and ABO-incompatible transplantation, and then paired kidney exchanges. And the ones that are highlighted in green are the ones that I'll give you some examples about, but I've done some other stuff as well. So there are steps in a process of bringing new ideas to clinical reality. The first, obviously, is the development of an idea. The second is to be able to get buy-in within your institution. If you can't get it buy-in in your institution, you're not going to be able to do it. You may or may not need financial support. You probably will need some form of regulatory approval. And then you'll probably have to deal with third-party payers who say, we don't want to pay for any of this because this is new and experimental, because they don't want to pay for anything. Then you're going to have to deal with patient selection and recruitment. Then you're going to need data collection and analysis. And as I'll show you, there's learning curves involved with anything new that we do. Then in order to get it, then you're going to need to present and publish your data and get the dissemination and adoption so other people will do it. So this is the process. So lesson number one, address an unmet need, problem, or situation that could be improved upon. This is redundant with innovation step number four, which is, you know, problem solving. So with the laparoscopic donor nephrectomy, what we wanted to do was remove the pain and make it easier for people to donate, to remove logistical and financial disincentives to donation. So let me just tell you a little bit about the history of laparoscopic donor nephrectomy so you can kind of understand what the thought process was. So in 1985, a gentleman named Arthur Smith, who was chairman of urology at Long Island Jewish Medical Center, first proposed a minimally invasive nephrectomy. And Smith was the first person to do percutaneous nephrolithotomies. And what he wanted to do was put a percutaneous nephrostomy into the kidney and then let that sit there for a long time so a big fibrous tract would develop, and then pass a resectoscope that they used to resect prostate cancers or bladder tumors through this tract and resect the kidney from inside out. And we all thought Smith was crazy. But a guy who I was interns with went into GU, and he and Smith actually did the first experimental minimally invasive nephrectomy, where they radiologically thrombosed the renal vessels, and then they shattered the kidney in a pig with ultrasound, and then tried laparoscopically to scoop up the pieces. And they published this, never came to clinical fruition. And we all thought, you know, Smith and Weinberg were crazy. I then went on to do my fellowship at Washington University, and while I was there, a urologist named Ralph Klayman did the first minimally invasive nephrectomy for disease. And in fact, what he did was he took the patient to the radiology suite, radiologically thrombosed the renal artery and renal vein, and then laparoscopically removed the kidney. And the whole ordeal from the time the patient went to radiology till they hit the recovery room was 12 hours. And we all thought Klayman was crazy for taking a two-hour operation and turning it into a 12-hour ordeal. But within a year, Klayman had been able to knock the OR time down to about 4 hours and could then do the operation also without prior radiological thrombosis of the vessels. In 1994, a fellow by the name of Indy Gill, who was one of Klayman's fellows, published a series of laparoscopic donor nephrectomies in pigs where he actually transplanted the kidneys and showed that they worked. In 94, also a guy in Korea named Yang performed a video-assisted donor nephrectomy through a small flank incision using purpose-built retractors. And then in 95, Luke Cavusi and I did the first laparoscopic donor nephrectomy. But there was a 10-year antecedent history that we were both aware of. Cavusi had also been one of Klayman's fellows and had been his fellow at the same time that I was the transplant fellow at WashU. And then there were a number of other developments, you know, which I could go on and on about, but I won't. Lesson number two is give credit where credit is due. You know, there'll be, if you come up with something new and you bring it to clinical reality, there'll be plenty of credit to go around. And this is the letter that I received from Lou Cavusi after he had come to claim an interview in Baltimore when I was at Johns Hopkins Bayview. And in that letter, he wrote, as per our discussion, I am enclosing a preprint regarding laparoscopic donor nephrectomy in an animal model. And there's Lou Cavusi. And I know what you're thinking, that Lou looks a whole lot like Borat. and Similar to Clark Kent and Superman, the two have never been seen in the same place at the same time. You could draw your own conclusions. So the first laparoscopic donor nephrectomy was performed in February of 1995. The patient went home on post-op day number one, which was unheard of at that time. In those days, donors usually spent 5 to 7 days in the hospital. Recipient did great as well. The donor came back to us the first week. He said, "I want to go back to work." We said, "What do you do?" He said, "I'm a welder." We said, "That sounds like pretty physical work. You can't go back yet." He came back the second week and said, "I don't care what you guys say. I'm fine. I'm going back to work." And he's back to work within 2 weeks. Again, totally unheard of in those days of open donor nephrectomies through a flank incision with rib resection, all that. We sent the case report to Transplantation, and it was rejected outright within 2 weeks of submission. It was actually never even sent out for review. And ultimately, I appealed to the European editor, and the paper went from being flat-out rejected to accepted with no revisions. And the case was published in 1995. So lesson number three, failure is not an option. Therefore, to optimize the chance for success, you must take ownership and pay strict attention to detail. This is particularly true for patient selection. So from the time that Lou Cavusi and I first started talking about the operation till we actually did it took 2 years because we were looking for the right patients. Here's the letter that I had received from Transplantation rejecting my paper. It said the paper is not acceptable for publications. And the reviewer wrote, "The real question is that standard living donor nephrectomy is so safe that its safety record should not be put in jeopardy. How many laparoscopic donor nephrectomies would have to be done to show that it's equivalently safe, and you'll never be able to get that many cases, therefore you shouldn't do it." And I thought that was ridiculous. And so lesson number four, don't take no for an answer. Oops. So I wrote back a rather terse letter to the editor saying, "The reviewer's assertion that it will be difficult to prove that laparoscopic procedure is equally safe and efficacious should not preclude its discussion or its further safety." I then went on to say, you know, if you don't want to make it look like you're endorsing this procedure, write an editorial and say this is crazy, but don't prevent it from being published. And eventually, when we appealed to the European editor, he was able to get it approved. Now, before we had it published, I went to a transplant meeting. We had done several cases, and someone asked me what's new, and I said, "Well, we've done laparoscopic donor nephrectomy," and after everyone regained their composure, a very prominent transplant surgeon said to me, "You probably have never been sued, because if you had, you would never do anything so stupid." So, again, prepare for criticism. So lesson number five, do not be discouraged by conventional wisdom, orthodoxy, experts, or the establishment, which do not appreciate this problem or need. And again, this is similar to innovation step number nine. A corollary to lesson number five is expect resistance, criticism, and false allegations of bad results. I can't tell you how many times people will call me up and tell me that they heard that I had killed somebody. It wasn't in relation to the laparoscopic donor nephrectomy. But anyway, you have to prove your point. You have to demonstrate and show the data and have good data. And so this is from an early series that basically showed that the analgesic requirements post-discharge were dramatically reduced in a statistically significant fashion, both for prescription narcotics as well as over-the-counter medications. This is a study that came out of University of Michigan, which then showed that hand-assisted laparoscopic donor nephrectomy versus open donor nephrectomy via flank incision without rib resection resulted in the patients feeling they were 100% back to normal in about a month, whereas at 4 months, less than 50% of the open patients felt that they were back to normal. So we also had to show that this operation was not deleterious to the recipient. Sure, it was great for the donor, but are you robbing Peter to pay Paul. So we had to show that there was good function early on, which we did. We showed that long-term function of the transplanted kidney was equivalent. We showed that the graft survivals were equivalent. So lesson number six is honestly and openly report negative data. People won't believe your positive data if all you ever report is positive data. You need to report the negative data. And I think that this is probably the most important thing that I could tell you today. Don't bury your problems. So you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't, so I recommend that we do. So this is a series that we published. It was our first 381 cases of laparoscopic donor nephrectomy, where we basically showed that we broke it down into quartiles, and that as our experience increased, the complications decreased on the donor side, the recipient complications decreased, allograft loss decreased, and in all there was a learning curve. There are a number of other groups that published data about a learning curve, particularly in terms of blood loss and time required to do the operation. And so there's actually not one learning curve, and it's very important to be cognizant of this when you're bringing new ideas to clinical reality. There's an overall learning curve, but if you break it down, there are actually three components to the learning curve. The first is that of the procedure itself. And if you're developing a new procedure, it's not going to be perfect initially. It's going to be an iterative process. And that was absolutely true with the donor nephrectomy. Second is there's a learning curve for every individual surgeon or practitioner. And then the third is there's an institutional learning curve. So if you take a surgeon out of an institution, even though he may be very well trained and facile with the procedure, and plop him down in a different institution, do not expect to get the exact same results. It's going to take a while to get the institution up to speed, particularly in things like patient selection and all. And similarly, if you have a well-running institution and you bring a new surgeon in, you're going to not get the same results again. So the three components need to mesh. Lesson number seven, broad application is more important than maintaining a monopoly. Share your data and ideas generously. And again, here we have our adoption curve. And I think this is so important that we'll go over it a little bit again. Again, you want to get these people, the naturals, to pick up on the idea and get people with sufficient gravitas that other people will respect and listen to. Now, early on, we did surveys of why people had adopted the operation. And when we did this survey, there were 130 centers worldwide doing this operation. And 3/4 of the centers said they did it because they thought there was a clear advantage to the donor. 60% thought it would increase the number of living kidney donors, which, again, was our whole rationale for doing this operation. Half the centers began doing it because their patients were asking for it. So the patients were driving the process of adoption. I think this is kind of funny. 1/4 of the centers said they adopted it because they were losing patients to other centers. 1/4 of centers said they did it for marketing advantages so they could steal patients from other centers. So that's why people began adopting it. Anyway, as we intended, as the number of laparoscopic donor nephrectomies increases, the number of living kidney donors increased and essentially doubled with the adoption of the operation. And now it's become, by 2008 in the United States, it was pretty much standard of care. And the UK, it took a little bit longer, but again, now pretty much standard of care. And the reason I bring up the UK is because the initial criticism of our first paper was we'd never be able to show that it was equivalently safe as the open donor operation. And in the UK, they had a prospective series that a prospective registry of all donors and complications. And they were actually published and demonstrated that not only the laparoscopic donor nephrectomy was equivalently safe, it was safer in terms of overall morbidity. Mortality turned out to be exactly the same. And the morbidity, the reason that it's lower in the laparoscopic nephrectomy versus nephrectomy via flank incision was mainly because of less incidence of pneumothoraces and less wound infections in the smaller laparoscopic incisions. And this is sort of the impact that this has had on the field. So if you did a web of science search for live or living donor nephrectomy, you could see the number of publications prior to our first report and then how it totally dramatically changed the entire field and made it a very fruitful area for investigation. So lesson number 8, multiple publications or presentations that address individual aspects of the topic are better than a lesser number of comprehensive papers. Okay. First of all, it's much more difficult to get comprehensive papers by reviewers. The reviewers will frequently say, well, it's too broad and, you know, I want more about specifics. And so you're also better off because you reach a wider audience if you have more and more papers. Lesson number 9, presentation of ideas and data must be repeated over and over and over before it's accepted and believed. Find multiple venues to report your work. And this is similar to what politicians do. They say the same thing over and over and over till you believe it, okay? And now, the other thing is particularly if you're trying to reach broader audiences and different audiences. So for instance, we not only had to get our surgeons to believe in this operation, we had to get nephrologists to believe in the operation, okay? So, which leads me to the next. So this is a advertisement that I took out of a Lufthansa magazine when I was in a taking a Lufthansa flight to Germany one time. And imagine my surprise when I saw this ad, because in Yiddish, the language of my forebears, the word schmuck means penis. Okay, so imagine you see this ad for schmuck art, but apparently in German, schmuck means jewelry. And maybe it's the family jewels or something like that. But the point is, when you're talking to different audiences, you need to speak their language and address the issue in their language, okay? Now we'll switch gears and talk a little bit about use of immunologically incompatible donors and the lessons learned there. So my personal odyssey was that in the mid-1990s, we had a number of patients that had antibody-mediated rejection. At that time, antibody-mediated rejection was pretty refractory to conventional rejection therapy. And sort of as a last-ditched heroic effort, we said, okay, let's plasmapherese them, because we know plasmapheresis will remove antibodies, and let's also give IVIG, because we don't want to make them so immunosuppressed by removing their antibodies, because we've already given them a ton of immunosuppression. So let's give them IVIG back, and hopefully that will also help to serve to down-regulate the production of the donor-specific antibody. And at around the same time, we were developing the laparoscopic donor operation, and more patients were coming forward with live donors. And although the percentage wasn't any different, the magnitude, you know, the number of patients was different, because before we were seeing, you know, we'd see 2 or 3 patients a year who had antibodies against their donors. And we said, it's not really a big problem. But now we're seeing many more patients. We're seeing a couple of dozen patients a year. It was sort of a problem that we could sink our teeth in. And there was a realization that there was a large untapped source of organs for transplantation there. And we figured that if we could use plasmapheresis and IVIG to treat an ongoing antibody-mediated rejection, that's sort of the worst-case scenario. Why can't we also use that to treat them up front and remove the antibodies even before they have rejection? So Again, the old paradigm was antibody-mediated rejection was a dreaded complication that resulted in a high likelihood of graft loss, either due to hyperacute rejection or subsequent sort of acute antibody-mediated rejection, and that preformed donor-specific antibody yielded a high likelihood of antibody-mediated rejection, either due to alloantibody against the HLA antigens or against the blood group antigens, and that transplantation in its presence should be avoided, and people develop more and more sensitive tests to detect lower and lower levels of relevant antibody. And that was sort of a nihilistic approach because you would just rule those people out, sort of like these horse hospitals. So now, how to do this, okay? So lesson number 10, couch all discussions in terms of benefits for patients. You know, no one cares about your academic career. Well, that's not exactly true, but no one cares. You know, what they want to know, are you going to benefit patients? And you won't be criticized for attempts to benefit the patients. So that changed our paradigm that the antibody-mediated rejection could be effectively treated. I won't go bore you with the rest of this. But one of the things that we found, one of the things when we started doing this was people said, oh, we tried that, it doesn't work. And this gets back to the innovation where you look for assumptions that may not be valid. And I went back and I read every single paper that looked at desensitization. It was true that people had tried plasmapheresis for desensitization and with equivocal results, but there were some successes. And when I looked at those papers, and I read hundreds of papers, I saw that everyone who had tried plasmapheresis for desensitization were using a finite number of plasmapheresis treatments. Why? Because if you plasmapherese people too much, they get coagulopathic because you're removing the clotting factors as well. And when you operate on them, they bleed and you have lots of complications. So they would say, okay, if we only do three treatments or five treatments, we could deal with the coagulopathy. And I said, well, that doesn't make any sense because the antibodies are present in different titers in different people, and it's probably that they're not doing sufficient plasmapheresis in people who have higher titer antibodies, why it's not working. So I went to our pheresis people, our blood bank people, and I said, how do you minimize the coagulopathy? They said, oh, it's easy. Don't do the pheresis every day. Do it every other day, and the coagulopathy is minimized, and then you could open it up to a broader use and do an indefinite number of pheresis procedures. So again, going outside your own field to find the solutions to the problems. So lesson number 11, prior unsuccessful attempts did not negate a good idea. The corollary to lesson number 11 is critically review the literature extensively and in detail. The devil is in the detail, and again, look for assumptions that may be invalid. So now we have a totally different approach. You know, we want to know if donor-specific antibody is present, what's the specificity of the antibody, what's the titer, is that titer sufficient to cause hyperacute rejection, what does it take to eliminate the antibody, is that antibody gone after treatment, and could the antibody be detected after transplant. Now, one of the problems we had was that people were reluctant to pay for plasmapheresis. Okay, and particularly if we were going to do it as a study that needed IRB approval, we were going to have problems there. And also, you know, did we need IRB approval to treat patients and all? So lesson number 12 is don't rely on routine channels and for administrative approval. So in other words, when you go onto your IRB's website and it says this is what you need to submit, don't just do that. Speak directly with those people who provide the final say in decision making. Once the groundwork has been done, then go through routine channels. Now, you know, although they say don't call, don't talk to people, my personal experience is that when you call the people and when you talk to them, they're happy to hear from you, they're happy to give you their advice. because they don't want to review a whole bunch of crappy proposals, and they don't want to see the proposals coming back to them. They'd rather have you get it done right first, and they're also kind of, you know, they kind of like that you're including them in the discussion. This says, frankly, Mr. Ferguson, your case has us baffled. How did you get in here without insurance? So lesson number 13, repetitiveness and persistence with third-party payers may be necessary. Be a pest if you have to. Communicate directly with the medical director. Get an exception for one case that so that a precedent could be set. So we wanted to get people, the insurers, to pay for plasmapheresis. It's very expensive, and there's no way we could have done it without that. And I'd call and I call and I call, and finally, just to shut me up and leave and to have me leave them alone, the medical directors would usually say, "Okay, you know, let's do it for this one case," and then the precedent was set. The problem stemmed from the fact that there was specific regulations in the Medicare guidelines, and I don't know how the regulations got there, that basically said plasmapheresis will not be paid for in preparation for renal transplantation. Probably something from 30 years beforehand or something. But we called Medicare, we called Medicare, we called Medicare, we'd get a whole runaround. And then we were also able to show that we were able to, that you could save money with desensitization and all, and with kidney paired exchanges. But the real turning point was in 2001, right after I left Hopkins, the summer of 2001, prior to 9/11, George Bush came to Hopkins to give a talk about healthcare. You could see former governor of Wisconsin, Tommy Thompson, was there. He was the Secretary of Health and Human Services. That was the Dean Ed Miller. But, you know, the real hero was this gentleman, Bob McEwen, who was the transplant administrator. And George Bush was meeting with the muckety-mucks of the medical center. And he basically said, well, if there's anything you need, let me know and I'll try and help. And Bob McEwen piped up, and here we're getting back to Pasteur, chance favors the prepared mind. He said, well, you could have Medicare pay for plasmapheresis for in preparation for renal transplantation for desensitization. And of course, George Bush said, well, how many plasmapheresis treatments do you need for what antibody type? No, I'm just kidding. he said, huh? But anyway, he turned to Tommy Thompson, and he said, look into this and fix it. And that's how the regs got removed, and we opened the door so that we could get this paid for. So then that led us to paired kidney exchanges. Many of you know that, you know, this is done commonly now. If you take any random pair of individuals, 65% will be ABO blood group compatible. And as a demonstration of this, I did this yesterday when I talked to the transplant grand rounds. Everybody who's blood group O, raise your hands. Not too many. Anyway, look around and see who to be friends with, because obviously those are your universal donors. But the way to overcome, rather than immunologically, organizationally, is to swap donors. So if I'm blood group A and my wife is blood group B and I want to donate to her, and Dr. Kaufman is blood group B and his wife is blood group A, we could swap wives and get the transplants done. So now, in order to do this, you know, this takes a big team. You know, initially we were doing them all simultaneously, so we would, to do a simple two-way exchange, we would need four operating rooms and all. So so in order to accomplish this, you need to get buy-in within your institution. You must personally communicate with individuals on every level of the team to make sure they understand the rationale, goals, and the data that's already generated, so that they don't see it as some crazy endeavor, okay? Because you don't know who's going to sink the ship. You know, it only takes one nurse who doesn't get it, or an anesthesiologist who doesn't get it, that could kind of screw things up for you. So everybody really needs on board, and you need to take that personal responsibility and make sure that the whole team gets it. And then this led to these exchange chains, which we now do regularly, that Mike Reese reported in the New England Journal of Medicine. And again, this is the growth of kidney swaps in the United States, or kidney paired donation. So lesson number 15, do not be discouraged if a project is likely to take a long time. It just means that you need to start sooner rather than later. People often say, well, that's going to take a long time. Why should we do it? Well, do it now. Don't put it off, because it's only going to take longer if you put it off. But that's human nature. So, and then to invoke a former UW transplant fellow, Mark Stiegel, he said, nothing is impossible, but everything is a pain in the ass. So expect difficulties, and it's going to be hard, but it's worth it in the end. So we're almost done here. So in summary, bringing new ideas to clinical reality takes dedication, persistence, and attention to detail. Prior failures do not negate a good idea. Effective communication and salesmanship are essential. Buy-in from team members must be achieved. Honestly reporting of negative results increases credibility and is a necessity. Opposition is to be expected and may be long-lasting despite robust data. Messages must be repeated over and over in a variety of venues and formats before acceptance is achieved. And do not be discouraged by negativity of experts or the long, difficult road ahead. And now, the final thing I'd like to say is about mentors. And I've been fortunate to have two sort of scientific mentors during my career, the second of whom was Timo Hanakumar, who's a transplant immunologist at Washington University, whose lab I worked in. And he taught me three very important lessons. First is, don't be limited by what you know. More people limit themselves by what they know rather than what they don't know. They want to live within their comfort zone. Second is, know how to ask questions. And the third is, techniques are merely tools that could be learned as you need them. So he went from being a veterinarian to a cellular immunologist to very fine molecular immunologist, because he would tooled up and learn new tools to answer the questions that he was asking. And I think that that's really essential. The second, academic mentor was Günter Blobel, who is a cell biologist at Rockefeller University in New York. I was fortunate enough to have worked in his lab as an undergraduate and in medical school. And he taught me there's no reason to settle for mediocrity. This worked well for him. He won the Nobel Prize for his work on how proteins get sent to where they go in the cell. So the 15 lessons learned, in summary, remember, repeat them over and over and over again. Address an unmet need, problem, or situation. Give credit where credit is due. Failure is not an option. To optimize the chance for success, you must take ownership and pay strict attention to detail. Don't take no for an answer. Don't be discouraged by conventional wisdom, orthodoxy, experts, or the establishment, which do not appreciate this problem or need, and expect resistance, criticism, and false allegations of bad results. Honestly and openly report negative data. Broad application is more important than maintaining a monopoly. Share your data and ideas generously. Multiple publications or presentations that address individual aspects of the topic are better than a lesser number of comprehensive papers. Presentation of ideas and data must be repeated over and over before it's accepted or believed. Find multiple venues to report your work. Couch all discussions in terms of benefits for patients. Prior unsuccessful attempts do not negate a good idea. Critically review the literature extensively and in detail. The devil is in the detail. Don't rely on routine channels and mechanisms for administrative approval. Speak directly with those who provide the final say in decision making. Once the groundwork is done, then go through routine channels. 13, repetitiveness and persistence with third-party payers may be necessary. Be a pest if you have to. Communicate directly with the medical director. Get exceptions so that the precedent can be set. Buy-in within your institution is essential. You must personally communicate with individuals on every level of the team to make sure they understand the rationale, goals, and the data you already have. And then finally, do not be discouraged if the project is likely to take a long time. Just means you need to get started sooner. So thank you very much for your attention this morning. I've really been enjoying my visit here to UW, and I'd be happy to entertain any questions.